Good morning and welcome to our today's lesson. My name is Meshack Kodiko, teacher of biology. So today we are going to continue from where we left last time, that is on the effects of auxins on plant growth. So we had seen a lot of effects of these hormone auxins that is found at the growing tips, that the shoot tip and the root tip. So today we are going to look at what we call apical dominance. Apical dominance here, when I talk about the apical, then I'm referring to the apex of the plants that are growing, the tip of the plant. So apical dominance here is the inhibition of the growth of lateral branches, or rather the side branches, at the expense of the apical branch. So if we have, for example, a plant that is growing like that, so if the most of the auxins here are concentrated, so we have high concentration of auxins. Auxins here at the apex there. So when I'm talking about apical dominance here, the apex dominate at the expense of the side branches here. So it will inhibit, because of the high concentration that increase the growth at the apex, high concentration will hinder the growth at the side branches. So that's what we are calling apical dominance. That is, the auxins inhibit the growth of the side branches. So apical dominance is what we are referring to as the apical, the inhibition of the side branches at the expense of the apical stem. If the terminal bud, for example, is removed, the side branches develop the lateral branches. So that means that when you remove this one here, then you'll see the plant starting to sprout. The side branches will come in because you have removed the high concentration of auxins there. So the moment you remove that, then we are going to have high side branches growing in that case. So this is an activity that has been employed in the pruning. How is it employed in the pruning? When the many side branches are in, grow there, then we are going to have high yield of the crops. Then as long as the main stem is allowed to grow or remain intact, the development of side branches is going to be suppressed by the high number of auxins or high concentration of auxins that are found at the apex. So pruning is a terminal of the terminal bud, removes the main source of auxin, thus allowing side branches to sprout. So again, we have to look at the growth of what you call adventitious roots, which is another effect of the auxins. So adventitious roots develop from the stem. So auxins stimulate the growth of such branches. So this is what, if for example you look at sugarcane, we have a sugarcane that is having internodes here. So if you put this sugarcane on the horizontal ground, then there are roots that are going to develop here. What we are calling adventitious roots, they will develop. So this is also activity that has been employed in the growth of sugarcane, where the adventitious roots can be developed from the main stem in that case. So we have another thing that we are calling parthenocarpy. Let us look at the spelling as parthenocarp. The two R's are very, very important. So we talk about parthenocarpy. Sometimes we can ask ourselves that there are those fruits that do not have seeds, or maybe they do not carry out fertilization. So how do they form the fruits? Parthenocarpy therefore refers to the formation of fruits without fertilization. So that process by which fruits are formed without necessarily getting fertilized is what we are calling parthenocarpy. This can be induced by treating unpollinated flowers with auxin so that it promotes the growth. So this phenomena is applicable in the development of seedless fruits varieties, that those ones that do not produce seeds, or rather if they produce the seeds, then it will take a longer period of time for the seeds to be produced. So this activity has been employed in orchard farms where large-scale production of fruits is carried out. So auxins, together with the other plant hormones, are involved in the secondary growth. Let's say, for example, falling of the leaves and ripening of fruits. Like we talk about the hormones, like let's say gibberellins. We have things like cytokinins, florigen, and ethylene. Those ones are employed together in the production of fruits. Let us now look at how reception, response, and coordination occurs in animals. Having seen how it takes place in plants, we now want to see in animals. So in animals, it's a little bit more advanced. The reason being that the response in plants, in animals, is brought about by two systems. That is the nervous system and the endocrine system. That is, we talk about the nervous system and the hormonal. Endocrine is coming from the word hormonal system. So they're together known as neuroendocrine system and act as a coordinating what? System. So the nervous system and the endocrine system must coordinate so that they bring about a change in their activity. The linking of the receptors, for example, to the effectors, the parts of the organism that receive the stimuli are the ones we are calling the receptors, and those parts that bring about a change are what we are calling effectors and regulating their activities in the process. What are these things that we are calling receptors? Receptors are cells that detect or receive the stimuli. It could be like the skin, the outer one, and then they may be scattered more uniformly all over the body, or they may be found at specific regions. E.g. receptors of pain, those ones that detect the pain, those that detect the touch, temperature changes, or they may be located in a special sense, organs like, for example, receptors for light, those for the sound, taste, and even smell. We have what we are calling the motor neuron. The motor nerves link the central nervous system, that is the CNS, to the effectors. So, when we are looking at the cell itself, the nervous cell or the nerve cell, we have the nerve cell which is located at different points, that is the cell body. If we have a cell like this, we can have a cell with the cell body there. Then we have the terminal dendrites here. Then, receptor dendrites, these ones are receptors. Then we have the cell body. So we have different types here, terminal dendrites. We have terminal dendrites. Then we may have different parts here. We have things like what we are calling myelin sheath, like that. So, then we have the axon there. So, if we are talking about this, its cell body, that is the motor neuron, has got its cell body located at one end of the axon. Later on, we'll see the diagrams there. If we have this, then we'll have the cell body at one end there. Then we have the sensory neuron, we'll have the cell body of the axon. Then we have the relay neuron where the cell body is within the axon. So, it transmits nerve impulse from the CNS to the effectors, while sensory neuron will transmit the nerve impulse from the receptors to the central nervous system. That information is taken by the motor neuron via another synapse of the relay neuron to the effectors. So effectors are the cells or organs or other organelles which enable the organism to respond. They include things like muscles, they include glands, cilia, and even the flagella. So that alone, we've now seen some of the parts. We have seen the receptors, we have seen the effectors, we have seen the types of neurons and how they carry out their activities and how they are coordinated to bring about a specific change in an activity. So with that, we are going to come to the end of our lesson, and thank you for listening.